you know who I am because I host a show called Interspace on Space Channel, which if you're Doctor Who fans, well, you really need Space Channel because that's where you can see the new season of Doctor Who, Series 9, when it returns September 19th at 9 p.m. Hope you're all excited for the return of Capaldi. Now, I'm going to bring out our guest in just a second. She probably doesn't need much of an introduction, but I'll give her one anyway. Before I get to that, just a reminder, no flash photography, please. And I know we're here for a Q&A, and so some of you might be thinking, like, I'm going to be clever. My question is going to be, can I have a hug? Brilliant idea. You're not the first to have it. But let's just refrain from asking for hugs, please, because we want to listen to our guest, not just give one person an opportunity for a nice hug. With all that said, let's bring her out. You know her. You love her. It's Karen Gillan, everyone! You having fun in Toronto so far?
I've had so much fun. The last time I was here, it was such a fleeting visit, so this time I have lots of time to sample all the food. Just really why I'm here.
It's a pretty good destination for gastronomy.
I think so. So far, so good.
Now, I know you probably can't say much, so I specifically worded my first question. What can you say about Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2?
I can say that I have not read a script yet.
Okay.
that I will be back, and I still don't know if I'm going to be bald or not.
There's a possibility that you won't be.
There's a possibility. I don't know why or how, but there is.
Okay. That's pretty exciting.
Yeah.
And it was just announced you're joining a new film, The Circle. Am I getting that right?
Yes.
What can you tell us about that?
So it's a film about this internet-based company, and they sort of track their employees' lives quite extensively, and it's about how far is too far when it comes to documenting what you're doing all the time.
Cool.
Yeah, it's good.
Now, before we go to the floor, I should let you know we got Stefano and Gordon, I think. They've got microphones to take questions on either side, so if you guys want to start lining up at the microphones, we'll take turns going to you for questions from the floor. But, of course, your old friend, Arthur Darvill, is going to be playing Rip Hunter in the
Legends of Tomorrow.
Yeah. Have you imparted any advice to him on playing a superhero character?
So much. No, I haven't, actually. I feel like he has it down. He knows about time travel. He's done it before. I think he's well-equipped for the job.
Likely so. And lastly, when I was talking with Arthur, I think it was at Fan Expo, maybe on this very stage last year, he was mentioning something that you and Matt Smith and he played, a game of the uncomfortable touch.
Oh, yeah.
So can you tell us what that is for anyone who's unfamiliar?
Oh, the uncomfortable touch is such a fun game. So basically, if I came on stage and you don't know me, and I was just like, hey, so anyway, yeah, my time on Doctor Who was very, very great, and I just stayed there for ages.
I don't know if it works when you do it, though.
Oh no, I need to make it more awkward. Yeah, but like, sometimes we would do that to people who would come onto the set for the first time. It's weirder when the guys do it, I will say that. You can just gently rub someone's back. That's always weird, because they go...
Okay, let's go to the floor for some questions. We'll go to our left side first. Awesome Dalek costume.
Hey, it's a Dalek! Ah, woo! I was just wondering, you've done a lot of...
scary scenes for Doctor Who.
That's scary. And you said they watch Oculus?
Oh, yeah.
What is the... Sorry. What is the difference in filming stuff for a TV series and for like a horror movie? And would you like to do more horror movies in the future?
I had such a good time making Oculus, which is a horror film about an evil mirror. It doesn't sound as good when I say that. It's good though.
It is.
And yeah, I had such a good time. It was always a dream of mine to be in an American horror film because that's what I grew up watching. And my favorite film was Scream, and I just met the guy who did the voice of the killer. And I got to record on my phone and I screamed when he said, "What's your favorite scary movie?" So yeah, in a nutshell, I was really, I had a really good time on Oculus and I would love to do more.
Awesome. We'll go over here. Fantastic. Cosplay over here too.
How was your transition between the role of being a Doctor Who companion and the role of Nebula in Guardians of the Galaxy? Was it hard to switch between the two different sci-fis?
They were quite different characters. There were a few other characters in between those two, so I didn't have to... But you know what? It was actually weirdly similar going from Doctor Who to Guardians, because it's in the same genre, and I was sort of nervous because Guardians is like a big scale film, and I was like, I've never done one of these before. And then I got there and I was like, this is a spaceship. I know this. So it's good.
All right, we'll go back over to the left. Doctor.
So, obviously, Doctor Who is...
Oh, the mic is not working on this side.
Well, to the rescue. So, obviously, Doctor Who has become such a huge phenomenon ever since it rebooted in 2005, and... since you joined as a companion, it must have been a huge, huge culture shock. What was the biggest change that you noticed? What was the biggest, you know, thing that kind of scared you about taking on this huge role?
Well, I mean, in the UK, it is quite a weird thing to take on a role in Doctor Who, just because it's such a national institution and everybody knows what it is, and it's headline news when a person joins the show. And that doesn't normally happen because... Well, because usually you'll establish a character and a show and then you'll see it become successful. But this thing is already, you know, a huge thing of its own. So when I got the role, I was like, oh, my life, I know that my life is going to change. But I wasn't scared because I was 21 and that's, I had the sort of, I guess, blind optimism of youth. Where I was like, oh, it's going to be fine. If I got the role now, I would be way more scared.
And just... I just kind of want to know, what's your reaction to Capaldi so far?
He's great. I think he's brilliant. First of all, he's a brilliant actor. Second of all, he's Scottish, so he's a winner.
And on that vein, it was recently announced that Alex Kingston will be coming back.
I know, I saw that. I'm so proud. Proud of my child.
Quiet microphone. So, is there any chance that Amy and Rory might come back?
I mean, well, I've said before that I wasn't going to return, and my reason for that was because I wanted my departure to have the same impact years down the line. I wanted people to feel upset when they watched it. But then I went back. But then I went back for Matt's regeneration, so... Obviously, I lie about that stuff. So yeah, I mean, if they asked me to go back, I would absolutely do it. Yeah.
Hi, I liked you in Doctor Who, but I also liked you in the movie Not Another Happy Ending.
Oh, thank you. Oh, whoa, what a banter.
I was wondering if you were like Jane Lockhart and you wrote a book, what would it be about? Like, what type of genre would it be? What would you call it?
If I wrote a book, I think it would have to be about something that I've experienced or something that I know quite well, because I feel like if you're going to write that old saying, write about what you know, and I think it's more specific and detailed, and that's good. Maybe I would write about growing up in the middle of nowhere in Scotland, why not? See where that goes. Yeah, I would call it... I don't know what I would call it. What should I call it? Haggis and Tarzan.
Thanks for the question. Go over here.
What was your favorite Doctor Who episode that you were in and why?
Good question. It was the 11th Hour, because I think it was the best episode that Stephen Moffat wrote, actually, because he had that in him from when he was a little kid. It was always his dream to write for Doctor Who, and I think he had that plan for a very long time. So it was just a particularly magical, special episode. And we were playing the characters for the first time, and I thought my little cousin Caitlin, who played the younger Amy, did such a good job introducing my character, making people like her, so I was like, thank you. yeah, and it was just a lovely, brilliant episode, I think.
Can you tell us how she became involved in it? Did you suggest her? Did she?
I did. Yeah. So basically, they were looking for this little Scottish girl who looked like me and sounded like me, and I don't have the same Scottish accent as like the central belt of Glasgow, like of Scotland, like Glasgow. So they needed a particular one, and I was like, well, I had this cousin who looks like me. She's never acted before. She's never expressed an interest in acting. And they're like, just let us audition her. And then they auditioned her, I think, 3 times. So it wasn't that easy for her, which made me happy that she didn't just get handed it. you know, you've got a teacher that doesn't just come to you. But she nailed the audition. I think all the other little girls were really sweet and lovely, and then she just had a lot of attitude, and she put her hands on her hips, and she was like, what? You're a time drama, what? So I think she did a really good job with that.
Woo! And we'll go back over to the right.
This question's from my little cousin who couldn't be here. She's asking, out of all the villains in Doctor Who, which one's your favorite?
Villains? I don't remember. That's my cheesy joke, I'm sorry. It's actually the Weeping Angels. I think they're so scary and horrible. You have to look at them, which is the worst.
Thanks. We'll go over to the left.
When you played in the episode Fires of Pompeii, did you know that you were going to be a Doctor Who companion then, or did you have to re-audition for the part?
I did not know I was going to be a Doctor Who companion when I was in the Fires of Pompeii with Peter Capaldi, who didn't know he was going to be a doctor, so that was quite random. I had no idea, and I had to re-audition for the companion role, and by that point the whole team had changed, all the producers changed over, so it wasn't even as if they went, oh, that girl from that episode could do it, it was just random and completely separate.
We'll go back over to the right.
Hi. If you could be the companion of any other doctor besides Eleven, who would it be?
Whoa! I feel such loyalty to Matt. I think it would be David Tennant. I love his doctor. I think it's a really interesting version of the character. He's so energetic and charming, and yeah, I think it would be fun.
Back over to the left.
First, welcome to Toronto. It's my hometown.
Thanks.
Hi. So obviously Nebula and Pond are two completely different characters, so I was wondering if there are any similarities in the way you went on your acting process with them?
Which characters, sorry?
Nebula and Pond.
Oh, Nebula. They're really different characters. I don't know if there's any similarities. I mean, I hope not. I think Amy's a good person. in terms of the way I approached the roles, that was quite similar, just because with any acting role you have your way of trying to understand the person. So for me, I got to the bottom of why I think Nebula is the way she is, and I justified all of her behaviour, so in my head she is a good person. So they have that in common. That's about it, I think.
Well, on that note, do you think we could see her sort of turning to the good side in the upcoming film? Is there a possibility that she could...
Who knows what James Gunn has in store? He hasn't mentioned anything about that, but even if she continues to be bad, like, I think I understand why she's doing it. I'm like, okay, this makes sense.
We'll go over there.
Hi.
Hi.
Obviously, your role of Amy in Doctor Who is such a love character. Do you think you share any, like, personality traits with her?
With Amy Pond?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think so. I like the idea of just, like, assuming a completely different character and just acting it, but I think actually a lot of me bled into that performance, especially when you're playing something every single day for, like, 10 hours, and that's all you're doing. It sort of molds into you a little bit, and you mold into it. I think so. I think she's a bit more sassy and a bit more sarcastic, and just has a bit more attitude than me. She's like a cooler version of me, I would say. I love to be her.
But becoming a companion on Doctor Who is much like actually being a companion of the Doctor, in the sense that you're going on this fantastic journey that's brought you all over the world.
Yes. We always talked about that. Me and Matt would always sit down and be like, what's real and what's not? Because it feels like our lives have completely changed. We're going on this crazy journey, and I mean, obviously we're not really traveling through time, but like our lives have turned upside down. So we were like, oh, this is, it's sort of the lines are blurring between
reality and fiction.
But you do share that quality then, that, you know, taking the chance for adventure.
Yeah, I remember actively thinking that a lot. I'd be like, how did she feel in this situation? Well, how do I feel in this situation? Okay, I understand.
All right, we'll go back up here.
What's your favorite Doctor Who episode that you're not in?
You're not in?
Ooh. I really liked Doomsday with Billy and David, just because, I mean, it was so sad. But they're separated by the white wall, and his face is the saddest face I've ever seen. It haunts me.
And back over here.
Hi, my question is, who is your favorite superhero and why?
Favorite superhero is Spider-Man. I mean, I just want to shoot web from my fingers. Like, wouldn't that be so cool? Please make it happen for me.
See what I can do. Back over here.
Did you ever get made fun of being a ginger?
For being a ginger? Yes. Daily by Matt and I'm Yeah, definitely. I think it was more so when I was growing up, to be honest. Which is weird because I'm from Scotland and that's where most of the gingers are. But anything different, I think when you're a teenager, gets made fun of. It's like a targeted thing, so I definitely experienced that.
Do you have any advice for anyone out there who's dealing with bullying?
It's honestly gonna get better. It really is. Like, even if you feel like it's the worst thing in the world, you're gonna look back and you're gonna be okay about it one day.
Absolutely. Hit girl.
Hi, so I was wondering what your favorite companion was other than you or Rory?
Or me? Or Rory?
Yeah.
Rose. I loved Rose. I think she's so great. I think Billy is such a strong actress. All of the companions I think were such strong actresses, but I just think that character and her connection with the Doctor was really special.
Back over here.
Is Rory your actual boyfriend?
What, in real life? He's married, not to me. So that would be terrible if he was. No, he's not, unfortunately. We just did a lot of pretending.
Thanks for your question. And another hit girl.
I was just wondering if you watched Doctor Who when you were a child and or, like, dreamed about acting in it.
Well, it wasn't on when I was a kid, which is a travesty, and I'm so mad at the BBC for that. So it wasn't on to me. I didn't really get to watch it growing up and have that amazing experience of being a child and being like, what is this? But then it came back in 2005, and I watched it with my mother because she's the biggest Whovian I've ever met. She loves coming to these things. And she sort of introduced me to it, and I remember thinking that the acting was really strong, and it's hard because it's all these high-octane situations and it's life or death all the time. And, you know, so it's not just like a TV show where you're walking around corridors talking, like, it's not, you're not playing a doctor or something, like in sort of ER or something like that, I don't know. So it was just like a totally different thing.
So was it difficult watching the episodes with your mom then when you were on it? Was she critiquing the episodes in terms of, you know, the canon and such?
She would always come up with theories and things. She's like, I think that means that, does it? And I'd be like, I'm not going to tell you that. No way.
No spoilers.
Yeah, exactly.
Back over here.
Okay, hi. So I was wondering if, like, as an actress, is there any people, like, that you idolize and want to work with, or any specific roles that you would like to have? Like, if you envy any actors for having certain roles, I guess.
Oh, I'd love to work with Tilda Swinton, because I just think she's so amazing. Like, such gravitas. I would love to work with Matt again, just because he's the best actor I think I've ever worked with, just in terms of how we work together. And he's one of the most generous actors. So even when he's not on camera, and you're on camera, and he's sort of, you know, giving you the lines, he works so hard to provoke things out of you. And so we never ever had to fake laugh. He would always do something to make me laugh and stuff like that. And that's when acting is really enjoyable, when you're not even acting, it's like reacting. And he did that for me, so he remains my favorite one to work with.
Well, on the topic of potential roles, I mean, this is a sci-fi convention, so I've got to ask you, obviously work with Disney, with Guardians of the Galaxy, and Disney now owns Star Wars, so if an opportunity presented itself, is there a role that you would want to take on in Star Wars? Is there a character you would love to play, even just making one up off the top of your head?
Here's what I want to do in Star Wars.
You've thought about this.
I've spoken to my agent about this as well. I want to play like a weird-looking alien that you've never seen, nobody knows it's me, and I'll just walk past in the background and have no lines. Like, that's all I want. That's not so much to act, is it?
I don't think so.
Like the old stags coming out of my head, maybe? I just walk past. That's all.
Let's make this happen.
Hi, thanks for coming to Toronto. My daughter Shai, she just wanted to say hi.
Hi.
It's funny because in Fires of Pompeii, I didn't know you were in it, and we were watching together, and she's like, oh, that's Amy Pond, like, what are you talking about? And we fast-forwarded to the end, and it's blah, 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 Karen Gillan. I'm like, what? How did I see that? And my question was, Doctor Who is a cool show, but it has, like, really weird stories. Have you ever had a script where you're like, I don't know what this is about, or I don't know where this is going? Like, the stories are so out there.
Yeah, and then they come to make sense a few episodes later sometimes, which is like, so you just have to bide your time. But I remember being really confused by the flesh episode when I first read it. The two-parter with the flesh, because it's much easier to watch that visually than read on a page, because there's two of everyone, and I was like, what is happening? So that was probably the most confusing for me. And then I watched it and I understood it.
Thanks for the question. We'll go back over to the left to TARDIS.
Hello.
Hi.
I was wondering if you ever got a chance to try fish fingers and custard. And if you did, what you thought about it.
I've never eaten it. Perfect. Okay, I think we should all try it tonight. Should we do it? Yeah, okay. I think we should all eat it at the same time. Kids, get your parents to eat it with you.
We'll all meet at the Boston Pizza across the street.
Yes, good. No, I'll eat it.
You're up.
Hello, Karen.
Hi.
You look beautiful.
Oh, thank you. You're from the UK?
You're right. So, basically, there are a couple of things I was going to ask you. The first one is, would you be interested in doing a spin-off from Doctor Who as to what happened to Amy and Rory when they went back into the past? And that could run concurrently, kind of like the Sarah Jane Adventures ran with Doctor Who in the past. And the other thing on an unrelated note is, could you please sing for me, in fact, for everyone, your wee Gaelic song that you learnt at school?
Okay, I'm going to start with the song. Ready? Oh God, why am I always doing this in front of people? Okay. Minne mere yoya vek kunya vere gungo kunya vere kota this clock as the fugo minne mere yoya vek kunya vere gungo. When I was doing that in school, I never thought that I would be doing that in Toronto. That's really random. What was the other? Oh, yeah, I would love to do a spin-off. Absolutely, that would be great. That was a good pitch as well. You need to tell Stephen Moffat that.
Can you turn that on? Yeah, I was also wondering, because I know that you're into producing and directing and that kind of thing. And perhaps you could do some background stuff to that. Like, another idea would be, what happened to me before, like after the Doctor left, but before he came back, but that would have Caitlin in the lead role. Maybe you could do some
directing. Yeah, like this. Then I could just direct it, be in the background. Smart. I'm loving these ideas. Yeah. Just have Caitlin in front
of you. We'll go back over here.
Hi, Karen.
Hi.
My question was, you recently directed a short horror film.
Yes.
I wanted to know what the inspiration for that was and your experience with it, and also if it's getting a public release anytime soon.
It is getting a public release. These shorts are really complicated. I want to just tweet them, but I'm not allowed. So people are stopping me. But this one that I just made is my second short, and it's set at a horror convention. And it's really funny. Well, hopefully, I think it's funny. And it's about a girl who was in a horror film sequel and then didn't do anything after that, and she's sort of like dealing, and she's had like a lot of surgery. So I play someone that's got like a lot of prosthetic surgery on her face, and it's just like, and then it gets a bit more serious when she starts talking about her life and stuff like that.
You got a title?
Conventional. She doesn't want to be conventional, that's her greatest fear, so yeah. And I think it's going to be online later this year.
Cool.
As part of like a horror short thing.
How short is short?
I think it's 8 minutes.
That's pretty good, cool. Yeah. Thanks for the question. We'll go back over here.
Hi, Karen. I was wondering if there was any doctor that you could play, which one would you want to play and why?
A doctor? Oh god. I don't know. Okay, I can't say Matt because that would be really weird. Myself as a companion. Maybe I'll play the first one. I will be the first doctor, William Hartnell. Why not?
Thanks. Oh, scary.
Hi. I have this question to ask about Guardians of the Galaxy.
Yes?
Who do you think would have won between Nebula and Gamora? If it had not been for a certain hull breach caused by the Infinity Power Stone on that Thanos the Mad Titan comics.
Who do I think would win? Nebula! Of course! She has a bionic arm! God's sake. Although Gamora's good. She's a really good fighter. She's known as the deadliest woman in the universe, so that's, you know, some competition. What? Someone just say.
Nebula fights dirtier. So.
She does. She doesn't play fair.
I'll go back over here. Hello.
Okay, hi.
Hi.
So, if there was a role reversal and Amy Pond was the doctor, do you think she'd be a good doctor and why?
If Amy was the doctor, oh, I don't know. Yeah, I mean, I think she would try really hard to save the universe. Although I kind of like her as the companion because she gets to sort of like be all sarcastic and make fun of the doctor. And that was quite a nice position to be in. I'm not sure I want to give that up.
Thanks.
Hey, okay, hello. Come lost you.
If you could change anything about Amy Pond, what would you change and why?
If I could change anything? Oh, maybe she doesn't look at the angel. Leaves Rory. I mean, can I change that Rory doesn't get taken by the angel as well, and they just get to finally go to the pub that they wanted to go to. I just want to see them down the pub having a wee beer.
It's not too much to ask for.
They got.
Back over here, Hogwarts.
Hi. If you could come back to Doctor Who as a villain or a historical figure, who would you come back as?
As a villain
or a historical figure?
I mean, Matt always says I would make a good silence. Don't know what he means by that. So maybe I would do that and be all like, ugh, hang from the ceiling. Or I would come back as a historical figure. I mean, oh, maybe some sort of, I don't know. What's a good historical figure?
I'm not the right guy to ask.
I've gone like Jesus. I don't know. That is Jesus. That is such a bold statement. I don't ask myself as Jesus.
Okay, I'll watch that.
Come here.
Okay, so I saw you in Selfie when you did the whole Chandler thing, so I just wanted to say your voice is amazing. And my question is, if you could be in any musical, what would it be?
If I could be in a musical? One that Arthur Darvill writes for me specifically. That's what I would do. Because he is the most amazing, talented musician ever. Like, he can play any instrument you put in front of him. It's really weird and freaky. And any song, you can just shout out a request and he can just automatically play it. And he writes musicals, so I feel like this would be a good team up.
I like that idea.
Thanks
a lot. Thanks for the great question. Back over here. Hello.
Hi.
Hi.
I was wondering, how do you think your experience would be different if you would have filmed with a different doctor that wasn't Matt?
Oh, I feel like it would be a totally different experience, actually, and I'm so grateful to have had the one that I did. because I feel like it was a special time because everybody changed over. So I got to experience things for the first time while he was experiencing things for the first time, and we sort of bonded over that. We were both really young as well, so we were like, what is happening? But yeah, I feel like it would be good to work with another doctor. I mean, I did work with David Tennant very briefly, and that was really cool. I just remember, and that was in The Fires of Pompeii, I just remember watching him and Catherine Tate when we were shooting in Rome. And I remember seeing them come out of the TARDIS and do the scene when they first arrived. And I was like, oh, they have the coolest jobs ever. I was like, I really want to do that. But I really didn't think I would get to.
Thanks for the question.
Thanks.
A quick technical note for whoever's opting lights. That one is flashing a lot. It's kind of distracting. Here we go. Back over here. Hello.
Hi. I was just wondering, if you had worked with another doctor, do you think you would have had a similar chemistry as you would have with Matt? Or like, would it have been kind of completely different? Because you and Matt were both kind of starting out, and how you had just said, you know, David Tennant, you would have thought that'd be cool, but you know.
I do feel like it would be very different. I think that the chemistry that existed between me and Matt was very much informed by where we were both at in our lives, and also just him as a person and me as a person. So, and it was quite instant as well. Like, I remember when I auditioned, I had to read with Matt, and that chemistry sort of just started. It was like a spark almost. It was pretty cool. And I just don't know if I would have had the same thing with anyone else, to be honest.
What do you think the vibe would be like if you were to come back and, you know, do an episode with Capaldi?
I mean, it would be a lot of Scottish on the TARDIS. Painted tartan or something, I don't know. I think it would be quite funny, though. Yeah. Two slightly aggressive Scottish people.
All right, we'll go over here.
Hi. Hey, Karen. First thing I want to say is that I really loved Selfie, and I thought you were so amazing.
Thank you.
I was one of the people fighting so hard to keep it on.
Oh, thank you.
And also, I want to say thank you for all tall girls around the world, because seeing you with the doctor made me feel normal.
Oh, good. I'm so glad. It's okay, okay to be giant.
Look, you're very tiny. They call you the legs, but still, it's great.
I'll take it.
You had so many great moments with Amy and some really intense moments, and I know, just like you wanted, Angels Take Manhattan makes me cry every time. So was there any moment that really sticks out to you as super intense for you to film?
Oh, yes, so many moments. I mean, the main one is probably the obvious one. It was my last scene saying goodbye to the doctor. I hope you've seen it, and I'm not spoiling things. Yeah, no, that was really, really emotional, and I remember sort of like building up to it. First of all, I wouldn't read the script for a very long time, and Arthur and Matt were like, will you just read this thing so we can at least talk about it? And I was like, no, it's not happening. Just severe denial. And then I finally read it, and then I remember really worrying about how I was going to play it, because I was like, oh, where do I pitch this? This is the climactic moment. This is it. Like, if I'm ever going to deliver, it has to be me now. And I was like, oh, this is so much pressure. And then when I got there, I just remember feeling so genuinely upset, and I looked over and Matt Smith was sitting on a grave listening to The Carpenters close to you. And I was like, oh, I don't need to act at all. Like, this is just the worst day of my life. So it wasn't even acting. Thanks.
How did you pick yourself up after shooting that scene? Like, how did you get back to a normal level of happiness?
I mean, it wasn't the last scene that we ever shot, so we kind of just had to get on with it and shoot another episode afterwards, because we don't shoot them in chronological order. But I do remember sitting down on a grave and just staring for a second, and then I remember mid-scene just breaking character and being like, this is rubbish, this is just totally rubbish, and everyone was like, no, are you okay? So that was a bit of a weird freak out.
All right, we'll go back over here.
Hello.
Hi.
I have two questions.
Okay.
The first one is, how did it feel when you returned for the Christmas episode of Doctor Who?
And this was Matt's one?
Yes.
Matt's regeneration?
Matt.
Oh, it was really, first of all, it was really weird walking back onto somebody else's TARDIS. I was like, oh, this isn't, I don't have a sense of ownership over this anymore. This is really weird. But then I really had to sort of man up about it, because Matt was in a really weird place, because he was, you know, shooting his regeneration. Everyone was being really sort of tentative around the set. And then I found Jenna crying in the studio. She was really upset. And I was like, oh my God, I have to be the strong one here. I was like, do you need a cup of tea or something? and then I just remember trying to keep it really lighthearted the whole time. And I thought it would be funny to sing another one about the dust. Glad to be a part of it.
And you had a second question you wanted to ask?
Yeah.
Yes. This one is a bit silly. Would you rather return to Doctor Who as a completely different character and not be ginger? Or would you return in one full episode as Amy wear a Dalek suit?
Oh, wait. So I'm playing Amy in a Dalek?
Yes.
So can they tell it's me?
No.
I think I'm gonna do that. Yeah. I think I'd like to operate a Dalek. Do you know that's a real job? Like a Dalek operator. That's someone's job.
It's a pretty good job.
I know. I believe it's a job.
Thanks for the question. And speaking of Daleks.
So, sorry, I have two questions as well. The first one is really quick. What is your favorite charity that you would support?
Well, I think it would be people with a learning disability, something to do with that. Just because my father worked with people with a learning disability while I was growing up and volunteered at a lot of social clubs and stuff, so I grew up at those clubs. So I just like had a special bond with that. So I would definitely endeavor to support something along those lines.
And then the second one is, we saw you undergo a big physical appearance change for your role as Nebula. What was that like on set, having to be like covered in green makeup while shooting? Like, was that strange to see yourself, or?
Yeah, it's really weird seeing yourself transformed into an alien. Weird sensation. It was cool though, like it was just such an extreme experience, and it took like 5 hours in the morning. And if I don't shave my head, it'll take longer. So I'm considering shaving it to keep the time down.
Back over here. Hey.
Hi, Karen.
Hi.
Thanks for coming to visit us in Toronto.
Thanks for having me.
To see the sights and maybe at a Toronto Blue Jays baseball game. It's been doing really well. Toronto Blue Jays baseball game.
Oh, it's big. I've never seen a baseball game before.
You should go. It's amazing. They're doing really well. Yeah. They're playing this weekend. I also wanted to make a comment on Selfie. I found it interesting that you and John Cho are both in sci-fi and, you know, switched to comedy. Was that a hard transition, and do you prefer comedy over sci-fi?
Oh, I don't know if I have a preference, because sci-fi is so much fun. I mean, like, you get to run away from monsters, like, that's your job. So that's pretty cool. And also just, like, you get really dramatic scenes to play with, because, you know, people are dying. But I do feel like comedy might be slightly more my natural habitat. So I don't know, they both have their perks, but I just feel really at home doing comedy, like I don't have to suppress my weirdness. So I don't know, both are good.
You gotta write a sci-fi comedy.
Yes! Well, Doctor Who's pretty much both of those
things. Yeah, you were very funny on Doctor Who, so.
Thanks.
Thanks very much, we'll go back over here.
Hi, I just want to say I love you. And my question is, oh yeah. Oh.
Why do you think on it?
What was one of your favorite moments in Doctor Who, like on set, not as Amelia Pond?
Oh, on set. I mean, there were funny moments daily, and just having Matt and Arthur around, to be honest, I mean, they're just jokes. And they were constantly making fun of me, like, they pinned a picture of Mrs. Doubtfire to my trailer, because apparently that's what I sound like. They were constantly doing things like hiding in my trailer, jumping out at me, scaring the living daylights out of me. And then, like, whenever we would have guest stars on, they would really ramp it up, and then I found a way to bring them down. I was like, stop showing off because there's girls on the set. And then they went all quiet. So I was like, yes, I have one weapon.
Well, you brought up guest stars. Who's your favorite to work with, or can you recall a highlight with a particular guest star that was?
I mean, it has to be Alex Kingston. Hanson for me. I mean, she's just the coolest woman ever. I mean, just in real life. And she's such a brilliant actress. And yeah, just loved having her around. Yeah.
Mac over here. Oh, hello.
Would you marry the doctor instead of Rory?
Oh my god, that's such a hard question. I mean, what would it be like to be married to the doctor, realistically speaking? I mean, I guess you would travel with me in the TARDIS. So that could be quite cool. It would be like a never-ending honeymoon. I think I would marry Rory. I think I would. I like Rory.
I mean, if the doctor says, like, I'm just going out to get milk.
Like, you just don't know what's going to happen. It's a part of stability, you know? Yeah.
Got an awesome Dalek costume over here.
Hi.
Hi.
I wanted to ask, what do you miss most about not being on Doctor Who?
That would have to be working with two of my best friends, Matt and Arthur. Like, we became really, really close because we all had this crazy experience together, and they became my best guy friends, and so I just really miss working with them, to be honest. It was fun.
Thanks for the question.
Thanks.
Hello, Doctor.
Hello again.
Hello.
So, let's say you had the opportunity to write an episode of Doctor Who.
Yeah.
What would be in the episode?
It would start off with cardboard cups. Suddenly start moving of their own will. And then it turns out they're evil and they throw liquid on people in the face. And then I would have to go to the doctor. Especially Canadians for some reason.
Why did you ask her that?
And then the doctor and Amy have to come to Canada to save everybody from the evil cups. And then it turns out that the evil cups are just the manifestation of aliens from a planet called Eyesore. And then we have to send them back, and then they get frozen forever.
Someone send that to Steve Long. Nice pass.
Thanks. What's your favorite doctor's outfit?
Outfit? I think it'd have to be the one you're wearing. Full tie and fez. Wearing it very well.
Hello over here.
Hello there. Hi, Karen.
Hi.
First off, I just want to say thank you for saying the 11th hour was your favorite episode, because, like, that's basically what I just did.
Yay! Happy to be there.
Yeah, thanks. And also, I just want to ask, how is it like, you know, having to act in love with Rory or anyone, like, or being in a relationship? Like, was it ever awkward, or did it go along really well?
It's slightly awkward the first time you establish being in a relationship with someone on screen, just because you have to do things that would suggest that you're in a relationship, like touch each other, like couples do, and you don't really know the person by that point. And then you have to kiss and stuff, which is slightly weird, but then it's just acting. And then honestly, like, you do it so many times when you're filming that you just forget you're doing it. So I think, like, after the first sort of episode that I did with Arthur, we just forgot we were even doing that. Then we realized we were spending more time pretending to be married than we were not, which is quite strange.
Did you find yourself accidentally being kind of intimate with them when the cameras weren't rolling?
No, that never happened, actually. No.
Apologies to people. Well, go back over here.
Hi. So, first of all, I love you.
Thank you.
And the roles that you've taken on. So I was wondering what the most challenging role.
To do a lot of physical stuff that I'd never done before. Like, I had to learn this whole choreographed fight sequence, and that involved so much practice. I've never practiced so much on anything in my life. Like, they would make me come in every day that I wasn't shooting and just do, like, hours of working out, and then, like, I would learn how to, like, kick and punch, and so I feel like I can handle myself in a fight now, which is a handy skill, I guess. Hopefully not. So yeah, doing that stuff was quite foreign to me, so that was quite a bit of a challenge. Thanks.
Thanks for the question. We'll go back over here. Nice fans.
Thanks. Hi, Karen.
Hi.
I was just wondering, what's your favorite episode of Doctor Who that you were in?
That I was in?
Yeah.
All right, I've already gone with the 11th hour, so my other favorite would have to be The Girl Who Waited. Because I got to play an older version of Amy and see what I look like older. And now I live really healthily. And yeah, it was just cool because I feel like I got a bit more to play with emotionally, and yeah, it was fun.
Can you recall a set that you walked into that was like the most awe-inspiring or you know, blew your mind in terms of how awesome it looked? Because I remember that episode in particular, I really admired the sets that were.
Yeah, that one was a big one for me as well, just because I like Kubrick films, and that one looks like a Kubrick film, so that was cool, like all the white, and there was a lot of symmetry and stuff, so that was great. But also the Daleks episode, Asylum of the Daleks, that was probably the biggest set we'd ever had. I mean, it was huge, and they like shot some sort of huge fireball through it, so it was pretty epic to look at.
Back over here. Harley?
Hi.
Hi.
So, I just want to say that I really loved when you played Amy.
Thank you.
When she died in it, I literally started crying.
Oh, I'm sorry to make you cry.
It's okay. I really loved her. So, my question is, what was your favorite role that you've played?
Ever? Out of all roles? That has to be Amy Pond, just because she has a special place in my heart, just because, well, I think it's the longest time I've ever spent playing a character, and it was just such a crazy, life-changing experience, and everything was new and exciting, and yeah, I just couldn't believe what I was doing every day, and it just felt really special.
Thanks for the question. Got time for a few more. Nice t-shirt.
Thank you. So I have an amazing wife who let me, for our wedding, have a 2-foot-tall, 6-layer TARDIS as our wedding cake.
That's brilliant.
So I'm married 3 months ago, best day of my life. So,
great.
My question for you is, have you integrated Doctor Who into your own personal life?
I mean, I feel like it just took a huge chunk of my life, actually, in a good way. Naturally, and I didn't fight that. I just let it happen. And then also, like, my mom is the biggest Doctor Who fan, so whenever I would go home when not working on it, like, I was still very much surrounded by it. Like, she has Dalek bubble bath, little TARDISes everywhere. So, I mean, it just sort of, like, infiltrated my life, and I was very happy to let it do that.
She doesn't have, like, a big photo of you with the Doctor above the mantle or anything, does she?
I mean, not that I'm aware of, but it sounds like something she would do.
I can be here in the TARDIS dress.
Hi. I just want to say that you're my role model and you're awesome.
Oh, thank you so much.
And what's your favorite outtake or blooper from the docking?
Outtake?
That you were in.
Oh, I think it was maybe when we had to go in that whale tongue in the Beast Below. Just like trying to stand up in that goose stuff was jokes. And yes, we were falling over constantly. There was real cabbage in it. So that was good. We were in it all day, and I just remember not being able to get through a line without laughing. Like, I feel like I would love to watch all the bloopers from that scene, but I've never seen any. Thanks.
Okay. Time for maybe one more. Go for it.
Hi. This is actually my first convention. I'm so happy to be here.
Welcome!
And my question is, how did you react when you found out Riversong was Amy's daughter?
I was shell-shocked. I did not see that coming. And I remember me and Arthur trying to get that out of Alex Kingston constantly, because she knew the whole time. And I remember trying to give her wine, that didn't work. I couldn't believe it when I read it. And I was also really excited, because I felt like Amy became very integral to the full storyline, and that made me happy.
Well, Karen, anything you'd like to say to the crowd before we wrap things up?
Thank you so much for taking your time to come and listen to me ramble on. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Van Expo.